Last week we had budget. Market was extremely volatile. See, volatility during the budget is not new. Every year we used to see it. In 90s and all, what used to happen is that we used to get very good pre-budget rally. Then post-budget, whatever may be the budget, market used to fall. Like that used to happen in the 90s and all. So this time, this year what happened means we did not have a pre-budget rally, but because of some disappointment in the budget, on a budget day, market fell very sharply. Around 1,000 points it fell in Sensex. But all that has been bounced back in the following days. So almost we are back to square one where it was in pre-budget day. But budget, it has got a mixed response. So no one has told that it's a very good budget. Even Adi Godrej, who is a very conservative person, who is a very optimist, he has given just a six marks out of 10 for the budget. So overall, we can't tell it's a very good budget. It's a slightly disappointing because everyone was expecting that this budget will revive the economy like that, but nothing has happened. One thing which we can see as positive is that because of very high fiscal deficit, government may cut down their expenditure like that expected, but that is not, that hasn't come. So government can continue to spend it because government is the only one which is spending now. Both the private sector is silent, they are not spending because of lack of demand. Similarly, consumers also not spending. So government will continue to spend in the coming year also. That is the only positive we have. On global front, this coronavirus has been little dampener to the global markets. So we don't know how it will pan out. It's a known unknown risk. Everyone knows that there is some problem because of coronavirus, but no one knows where it will end, whether it will end by next week or whether it will continue for next 6 months or for 1 year, how far it will damage the Chinese economy and global economy, that no one knows. So the risk everyone knows is there, that coronavirus problem is there. So it's a known unknown risk that we have to see how it will pan out. The one positive thing for India because of this coronavirus impact is that crude oil prices fell very sharply. So that is one positive. From $65, it has come below $55. So that one positive thing has happened for India. And another positive thing which is happening on the background is that domestic economy is reviving. So that is another positive thing. July, August, September, our economy was extremely weak. And from that, if we compare, means from the bottom, it has started bouncing back. So a lot of data are there to suggest that the economy is bouncing back from the lows of July, August. And index, if you see, means Nifty and Sensex, it has come down by around 1%. Whereas mid cap and small cap, around 5% gain was there. So January, it's a pretty good month for mid and small cap sector. Whereas large cap stocks, it has been slightly subdued. Reliance has corrected. Because of that, index also fell. And even in index stocks, some stocks are still doing very well. Companies like Bajaj Finance, Nestle, Hindustan Unilever, they are still doing very well. And domestic economy, if you see, it has been improving. So some of the data, if you take, means GST collection, it has been very good. Very good in the sense that from the bottom, it has been recovering. When you compare to year on year, there is no major growth is there. But still from the bottom, it has been recovering. In the month of August, September and all, there was a degrowth in GST collection. But that has changed. Now growth has come back. So that is one positive indicator. Second is that the Coal India production, which directly relates to the power production in India, that has been started improving for the last 2 months. Previously, Coal India was producing less amount of coal. That means power production also was lower. That has gone. Coal India production has started improving. In the month of January also, there is a very good improvement in Coal India production. Similarly, power generation also, after 5 months of contraction, that also has started improving. So that these two data clearly indicates that things are reviving. And the manufacturing and service PMI, that also inching higher. So that is also a positive, which clearly indicates that the economy is on the revival path. And this is the PMI data. And if you see the PMI data, three months back, it was almost near to 51. Now it has gone to above 55. PMI data, generally how they used to calculate is that they will take survey from manufacturing PMI means they will take survey from manufacturing companies purchase manager, where they will ask what is the inventory level, how many orders you have placed, like that so many questions are there. and based on their feedback, they will compute it. Suppose if the data is above 50 means it indicates that economy is reviving. If it is below 50 means it indicates that recession is there. So from almost a flat growth, now almost 5 points it has increased in PMI, which indicates that some optimism is there among manufacturing companies, this data. Similarly, service PMI is also there. That also has improved. So these two data indicates that economy is improving. Because China is one of the largest consumer of crude oil. So when coronavirus hit came, they reduced their consumption, and that started reflecting in the crude oil prices from near to $70, which went up during assassination of one Iran military head. At that time, it went up to $70. From there, it has corrected to almost 20%. It has corrected. Now it is in bear market territory. Around $55, $54 it is trading now. So crude oil is very important for India because we import almost 80% of our crude oil. And what is important is that in the near term also, it is expected that crude oil prices will not go up. Market has become oversupplied, crude oil prices. So in the next 3 to 6 months, unless a huge geopolitical tension comes, crude oil prices will not go up. That is the opinion among the oil analysts. And inventory level has gone up to a large extent in crude oil. So the price, if you see that the future prices, if you see, means crude oil prices have come into a contango, charges have started coming in. Contango charges means that the future will start trading at a premium. So generally when it used to happen is that when storage cost start increasing means then the contango charges will start coming in. So after almost 7-8 months of backwardation charges, contango charges have started coming in, which indicates that the crude oil inventory is very high and crude oil prices unlikely to go up significantly till the month of at least August. So that is the feedback from oil analysts. Suppose if this coronavirus deepens means then possibility of further fall in crude oil is there. So crude oil price will give some support to Indian economy. Now coming into the budget, generally budget once in a year we used to see it. In olden days, no one needs to take an interest and see this. Now most probably because of this electronic media and all available, many of them may be. And if you see the budget, it will be very interesting. And each and every item, if you go through, it means it will be very interesting. You can just compare with what we are doing in our home. Like that, you can compare with what they are doing in the country. And the important thing is that government will continue to spend. So that is the main thing. So fiscal deficit will be higher because government is going to spend a lot. The second important thing, the structural reform, what they have done is the personal tax slabs made optional. So in this budget, what they did was they have reduced the IT rates for some slabs. But if you want to avail, that means you cannot get exemptions. If you want exemptions means the old rate will continue. So like that they have given an option. So it is a type of structural reform because for last so many years in India, what is happening is that they will used to give some exemptions in IT if you make some savings. So that is likely to go in coming years. So the exemptions like corporate tax, they have reduced it 6 months back. So at that time they told the same thing. Suppose if you want to avail exemptions means the lower corporate tax, you can't get it. The same thing they have now applied to the personal income tax also. So exemptions if you want to avail means the lower rate, you can't get it. And if you do, that is the option they have given. So it is up to our assessees to choose it, whether to avail the lower tax rate or to avail the exemptions. So basically what used to happen is the salaried class, they generally used to avail the exemptions, whereas the business class people who do not generally save money for and will go for exemptions, they may avail the lower tax rate. So that is likely to happen. And the third important thing is that dividend distribution tax has been abolished. So whenever a company gives dividend, they have to pay 15% dividend distribution tax. So already company is paying corporate tax, and opposed to corporate tax, that money if they want to declare as a dividend means, again they have to pay dividend distribution tax. That has been abolished. So it has been the long-standing request from the corporates. So corporates have got benefit because of that. But once we get dividend means, now we individual assessees, they have to pay tax on the dividend according to the slab. And the fourth important thing is that custom duty and many products, they have increased it. Mainly to boost domestic production and to discourage imports, the customs duty and many items like toys, furnitures, like that, the daily what we are using in our houses. In order to discourage, mainly this has been targeted towards China, because we are importing a lot of items from China, like very, very small things like toys and all, we are importing it. So that the customs duty has been high in order to discourage imports. And the fifth is LIC to be listed. So LIC is the India's largest insurance company, and it is to be listed. Most probably by FY21, it may be listed by late FY21, or it may next year it will be listed. Once it is listed, means it is expected that it will be the largest market cap company to be listed. That is what the expectation is. Right now, Reliance is the largest market cap. So LIC market cap will be higher than Reliance Industries. That is what the expectation is now. The other highlights is the new direct tax settlement dispute scheme has been launched. So if you have any income tax dispute, means government will waive off the interest and penalty. Just if you pay the tax amount, means they will settle the case. So that has been launched. It is likely to get good response, because interest and penalty is the big amount in dispute cases. So if that gets waived, means many of them were ready to pay the tax and to get settled with the dispute. That is likely to get a good response. And for housing, affordable housing, the 1.5 lakh for interest paid on loans, that has been extended one more year. Last year was there, so they have extended for one more year. And the deposited insurance in a bank, that has been hiked to 5 lakh from 1 lakh. Suppose if you have a deposit in any banks if goes bankrupt, means then you will get maximum 1 lakh. That is the insurance you have. Now that has been increased to 5 lakh. So we have to see that insurance is for per depositor. It is not per bank. Suppose if you have a deposit in two banks, and if you have 5 lakhs in two banks, and if both banks goes bankrupt, means you will get 5 lakhs only. So the insurance is for per depositor only, not per account. That we have to clearly see that. So per bank, per depositor, maximum 5 lakhs they will give. Then the fifth important is the divestment target has been set at 2.1 lakh crore. So last year, the current financial year, initially they set at 1 lakh. Now they revised it to 60,000 crores. Now for the next year, 2.1 lakh crore they have set it. So out of 2.1 lakh crore, almost 90,000 crore is going to get from strategic divestment. For example, BPCL, they are going to sell completely. Going to sell a major portion. So 90,000 they are going to get from strategic divestment. Balance 1.2 lakh crore, they will sell the other shares like IOC, NTPC, like that, whole India. So 2.1 lakh is a very aggressive target. So whenever I see the budget, I used to always worry, this is a fiscal deficit number. So if you see the fiscal deficit number, generally no one would get a sleep. So this year, what is the fiscal deficit number if you see, means for next year, that is budgeted estimate for FY21 next year, the fiscal deficit has been targeted at 7.9 lakh crore. So what is fiscal deficit is nothing but the difference between the revenue and expenditure of the government. So government will get revenue through taxes and other sources. Similarly, government have various expenses. So the difference is called the fiscal deficit, and it is 7.9 lakh crore. So 7.9 lakh crore means government expenses is more than its income. Government is getting an income as well as expenditure. So the balance deficit is 7.9 lakh crore. So what they will do is that they will borrow this money to bridge the gap between revenue and expenditure. So this year government will borrow around 8 lakh crore. And if you see in the last 5 years, the government borrowing in FY14, 5 lakh crore they borrowed, FY15, 5.1, 5.3, 5.3. So for this 4 years, almost fiscal deficit was almost stagnant. So that is why in percentage of GDP, if you see, means it has come down from 4.5 to 3.5% of GDP, because GDP has been growing every year. But from FY18 onwards, it started going up. FY18, 5.9, then FY19, 6.3, and in the last year, it has jumped very significantly, which is the current financial year, FY20. From 6.3 lakh crore, it has gone to 7.6, which is the revised estimates for current year. So this is the crucial thing, because government has been borrowing more and spending more money. Because of lack of private expenditure, government has been borrowing and spending more money, and that is why the fiscal deficit has jumped significantly in current year from 3.4 to 3.8, because the borrowing has gone up from 6.3 to, not borrowing, the deficit, 6.3 to 7.6. So next year also they are projecting to 7.9, but it is likely to, suppose if economy revives, means they will be able to manage this level. Suppose if economy did not revive, means then they can easily go to around 8.5 lakh crore, it can go. This is the deficit which comes into the budget document. Apart from that, government is borrowing through Food Corporation of India and NHAA. That is additional 2 lakh crore they have borrowed from small savings scheme. So if you add that one, means almost government borrowing is near to 9.5 lakh crore. It is coming for the current financial year. So everyone knows that money don't come freely. You have to pay interest for that. So 7.6 lakh crore means almost 7% government is borrowing. So next year what will happen? Government has to pay 50,000 crores as interest for this borrowing for current year. So next year again 50,000 crores. So the interest charge for the government will keep on going up. So why government is doing like this? Suppose if I take a loan, means I have to pay it. Suppose if I take 10 lakhs loan from the bank, means bank will ask me to pay it. I am the only person for answerable to that. Suppose if the government takes the loan, means they will borrow for 10 years, 15 years, 20 years through government bonds. So after 10 years, anybody will be in the government. Who knows which government will be there. So basically, we are putting the baggage on the future governments. So that is why everyone is borrowing without any problem. If I borrow, means I have to pay it. I have some responsibility on that. So government borrowing means there is no responsibility for that. That is why government keeps on borrowing it. Because it is the burden for the future government. It is not the burden for the current government. So like that it is happening for 30 years, 40 years. We don't know where this will end. Till the economy does well, they can be able to manage the and pay the interest. At some point, if economy gets weakened, means then it will become very difficult. Like Greece and all, it happened few years back in 2012 and all, where government did not have money to pay the interest. So at that time, they stopped paying pensions and salaries and all. So if in India the economy stops growing, means then we will start facing the issues like paying interest and all. And if you see the budget internals, the revenue receipt is 20 lakh crore without taking any debt. So 20 lakh crore is the revenue receipt, which is nothing but the tax incomes and all, GST collection, then the excise collection, customs duty, income tax, all these corporate tax, all this comes to around 20 lakh crore. So without taking the debt, 20 lakh crore is the revenue receipt of the government. Where is the expense coming? The top expense is interest payments. Because every year if you borrow money, means you have to pay interest. So 7 lakh crore is the interest payment. Almost 30% of the revenue, 35% of the revenue goes for interest alone. And food subsidy, 1.1 lakh crore. Fertilizer subsidy, 0.7. Petroleum subsidy, 0.4. So the interest payment and subsidies alone comes almost to 45% of the revenue of the government. This alone goes for the government. So yesterday Kerala had a budget. Any idea of what is the fiscal deficit of Kerala? Already Kerala government will have 2.6 lakh crore as a debt. So 30,000 crores is the fiscal deficit. So next year end, Kerala state government will have a debt of 2.9 lakh crore, because this 30,000 crores will get added. So like that, keep on adding it. No one worries about it. Whatever may be the fiscal deficit, we can issue statement like it's a plus budget, as if government is spending less than what it is earning. So this is the budget internals. In 1992, the fiscal deficit was 60,000 crores. Manmohan Singh presented at that time. So first time I am hearing that. So I worried that 60,000 crores, how government will borrow and pay interest. At that time, interest was very high, 13%, 14% like that. But at that time, 60,000 crores fiscal deficit. Now it has come to 8 lakh crore, but still India is surviving. So we should not worry too much on this macro details. We should keep on carrying our work. If we become pessimistic, means then we will lose a lot of opportunities because of by seeing this number. So these are all very interesting part, just we can go through it. So almost 45% of the revenue is going for interest payment and subsidy. And this is the picture of where the money comes from. So the main revenue comes from taxation only. GST collection 18%, corporation tax 18%, income tax 17%. Excise duty, this is mainly on petrol only, because after GST introduction, petrol is the only place where the central government gets revenue from excise duty, 7%. And borrowings, if you see, means almost 20% comes. Then non-tax revenue like PSU divestment, non-debt capital receipts is 6%. Non-tax revenue, 10% is there. PSU divestment, customs duty, 4%. Corporate tax goes to central government. So 18% is there. And if you see where the rupee goes, the main big expense is going for first the part of the corporate tax and excess duty, a part is shared with the state government. So 20% it will go for them, GST. It will go to the states. And the second main thing is the interest payment. So 20% we are borrowing it, and that money is given for interest payment. 18% of total spending goes for interest payments. Then the finance commission, other transfer 10. Central sector scheme, so many schemes are there. That is 13%. Centrally sponsored scheme, 9%. Pension 6%, and subsidy 6. Defense is 8. So main expense, if you see, apart from giving money to states, means interest payment is the main expense, 18%, because if you keep on borrowing, means the interest payment will keep on going up. So next year government is borrowing 8 lakh crore, means next after that what will happen, means the another 50,000 crore interest will go up for the next year, because this year we have borrowed more. Employee pension is there. This will come under the finance commission and other transfer, it will come in this. And budget allocation, if you see, this time because of very tight money issue, no major change in allocations. If you see the defense, almost it has been kept stagnant, almost 0%, no big change in defense allocation. Railway also just 3% for the namesake, they have hiked by 3%. So allocation for the railways is almost the same. Narega scheme, one of the flagship scheme, actually it has been reduced from 71,000 crores, it has been reduced to 61,000 crores, 13%. NHCA 6% has been hiked. For National Health Mission, almost flat. PM Awas Yojana 8%, which is for affordable housing, this one is for. And PM Gram Sadak is for rural roadways. Almost 38% they have increased it, but the base is small, only 14,000 crores. If you see these schemes are almost 30,000, 40,000 is there. This is just 14,000 crores, so the base, because of a very low base, 38% increase is there. Then crop insurance 15. Amrut and Smart Cities, this is for Smart Cities development, 39% increase is there. So only for rural roadways and Amrut Smart Cities, there has been significant allocation. Whereas the other things, the allocation is almost same. So this, which is going to become the reality, is the IT exemption will become history. Most probably before this government goes, they will bring it. Right now they have given option for us to choose whether to go for exemptions or to go for new slab that they have given. But by next year onwards, one by one exemption they will start removing it. By next 3-4 years, the entire exemptions they will remove it. That is likely going to happen. So what is going to happen because of this, that generally two types of assesses are there. One is the salaried class, the other one is the business class people. Two types of assesses are there. So those who are mainly claiming exemptions, if you see me, mainly salaried class, they will claim exemptions. They will go for a ELSS scheme, they will go for insurance scheme, they will buy a house, and they will claim it because they won't do other expenses. That is why they used to go for these exemptions. Whereas business people, what used to do is that they generally don't go for these insurance schemes because the returns are very less, and most of all they need money for their own business expansion. If you put money in their own business, means they will get 15%, 20% return. Whereas if you put money in this insurance, means you will get just 4% return. So even after considering exemption, if you see, means business class people, generally they prefer for paying higher income tax. So because of very high income tax, they generally tend to avoid that by not showing that income. So what will happen now is that because of lower tax rates, business class people, they will start showing their genuine income, but they don't go for exemptions, but they will go for the new slab rates. So this is one positive thing which has happened now. Moreover, retired peoples are there. They don't want to go for these insurance policies or ELSS. They want to spend like whatever they want. They want to keep some cash for their immediate need. So So retired people also likely to go for new slab rates. That will become fit for them. So it's a big structural reform which has happened, because for so many years IT used to have some exemptions. Now that goes away means lower tax rate without exemptions means is a big thing. So it will discourage the savings. So that is the one negative thing, because if you whatever money if you are getting means suppose if a 22 year old boy gets employed in an IT company, gets a salary of 70,000-80,000 means for at least for savings, for reducing income tax, he will go for savings, but this will discourage the savings, then he will spend whatever he like. So that is one negativity is there. So in the last 1 year, what has major thing happened if you see means corporates, they are the major beneficiary now. The first thing is reduction in corporate tax. Corporate tax rate has come down. That is why if you see so many companies, profit before tax is lower, whereas profit after tax is higher, because corporate tax rate has come down. That is one big positive has happened. The second thing is the abolition of dividend distribution tax. So because of that also corporate net cash outflow will be lower. So these two is very positive for corporate, and their net profit level will come down. For example, ITC last year they have paid 1,200 crores as corporate as a dividend distribution tax. So if dividend distribution tax is scrapped, means either they will go for higher dividend. Suppose if they don't declare higher dividend, means 1,200 crores will be saved by the company. So these two is a very positive, reduction in corporate tax and abolition of dividend distribution tax. That is why the stock market is pricing this. If you see a post corporate tax cut, many companies stock prices are going up. That is because of this thing only, the reduction in corporate tax. Now this abolition of dividend distribution tax, both are very positive for corporates. The next thing is the coronavirus. The Chinese economy, if you see, means last almost of death has crossed 700 people, and those who are infected, it is more than 30,000. So we don't know where it will end. No one has any clue on that. So everyone knows that one risk is there, but we don't know where it will end. And if it, suppose if it prolongs, means then the immediate impact, if you see, means Chinese economy will slow down significantly because of that. Because the government itself has told not people to come out of home unless it is very necessary, because they want to control that. And so Chinese economy, to see immediate slowdown, tourism and travel has completely come to a standstill there. And if it gets prolonged, means then global economy also will get impacted, because if you see many companies like pharmaceuticals, chemicals, many raw materials are coming from China only. Suppose if their shutdown is longer than expected, means then the entire supply chain in pharmaceuticals, chemicals will get affected. Consumer durables, if cell phones, even though it is not 100%, many individual parts will be coming from China. Even one part doesn't come, means then that also production will get affected because of that. So these things will get impacted if it prolongs. That we have to say today also in an article they have given in Tirupur in Tamil Nadu. People are very worried because government, some of the buttons and zippers and all coming from China, they have an inventory of 1 month. Suppose if it gets affected for more than 1 month, means then they will run out of inventory. Then end product will get stuck into it because of one or two items they are not getting. So they are also worried, and we have to see how it gets solved out. So it's a known unknown, we call it. The problem is there, but we don't know how it will end. So the other positive thing happened in the last 2 days post budget is the RBI policy. So RBI policy is one of the very, very good policy this time. To revive the economy, RBI has done two important things. The first one is that the status quo repo rate did not reduce it, because already interest rate inflation has gone up. So as expected, they did not reduce the repo rate. But they have done two things. The first thing is that banks can borrow from RBI at 5.15%, which is nothing but the repo rate. 5.15% interest rate banks can borrow from RBI at 1 and 3 years. If banks give G-Secs and government security as a collateral, they can borrow from RBI at 5.15%. For 1 and 3 years, which is the long dated one. 1 year and three years means it's a long dated repo they can borrow. Up to 1 lakh crore, RBI has given limit for that. So suppose if the 5.15 is a very very attractive rate. But if a bank borrow at 5.15% interest rate, means they can lend it at 8%, 9%, 2%, 3% net interest margin, they will get it. So it's one of the biggest positive. So they can borrow from RBI and they can lend money to the consumers if there is a demand. And the second one is that for loans to auto, residential housing and MSME, medium and small scale enterprises, from January 30, from February 1st onward, if they give loans to them, incremental loans to them, means then the CRR norms has been relaxed, which is also a positive. So this will incentivize banks to go for giving loans in auto sectors, residential real estate and MSME. So it's a two big positive announcement has come, which is overall positive for the banks. And finally, if you see, means in the last 2-3 months, some of them has been closely watching, except IRCTC is a PSU company. So if you leave aside IRCTC, almost every PSU company has fell very sharply. ONGC, if you see, it's trading almost a 10-11 year low. Oil India, whatever company, NTPC, blue chip companies, whatever, if it is Coal India, almost entire PSU stocks has been trading at an extremely low price, continuously falling. ONGC, it was trading around 170, 180, now it has come to 105 range. And if you see, means significant price damage has happened in entire PSU stocks, except one or two companies like IRCTC and one or two railways company. IRCTC has done very well. So apart from business fundamentals, for example, BHEL, if you take business, the business fundamental is weak because mainly they are supplying to the thermal power plant and the power generation is weak. So BHEL fundamentals are weak, so the stock price has fell, means we can accept it. But some of the companies like ONGC and all, stable cash flow they are having, still stock price is falling. NTPC, stable business, but still stock price is falling. So one of the reason is that the frequent supply from government keep on selling shares, that is leading to the fall. Even next year, now they have put on 2.1 lakh crore as a divestment target. If you leave aside this strategic divestment of 90,000 crore, 1.2 lakh crore they have to raise it. What they will do, they will keep on selling this Coal India share, NTPC share, like that they keep on selling it. That means the price will remain depressed because of that. So recently also CPSC ETF came. Last week it opened. CPSC ETF, anyone has applied for that? Around NAV is around 20 rupees is there. So this CPSC ETF, whatever constituents are there in that, means the price is continuously falling. So the reason is nothing but the government supply. So if you see the ETF, how it works, means initially the fund house in this CPSC ETF, Reliance is the fund, Nippon Life Asset Management is the fund house for that. So that is the one which is managing this PSU ETF. If you see, that means PSU, CPSC ETF, the name is, CPSC ETF is trading around 20.5, like that the NAV is. So Nippon Life Asset Management, they are managing this ETF. So initially how this ETF works, if you see, means initially they invite the bid from the public. So the fund house will get the bids. Suppose for example 10,000 crores worth of bids come, means so the ETF can 12 stocks. So some stocks will have 8% weightage, some stocks will have 4% weightage, some stocks will have 1% weightage. Suppose if they get 10,000 crores bid from the public, means then government will transfer its own shares to the ETF according to the weightage. So government will get that 10,000 crores, share will get transferred to the ETF. And after that, what will happen, it means these shares will become the underlying of the ETF. Post that, every day redemption will come as well as subscription will come. Suppose if there is more subscription than redemption, means then this ETF will buy shares from the market. Suppose if the redemption is more than the subscription, means then this ETF will sell its shares in the market. So mostly what is happening is that once the initial subscription is over, means generally redemption is used to happen in the CPSC ETF. That means the Nippon Life will keep on selling the shares in the market. That is the reason why this PSU ETF is not doing well, because the government has made it as a source of income, all these PSU companies. So they can, once after 5 years, 10 years, no company will be left with the government if they sell it, entire thing. So this is on one side, all the PSU stocks are trading at a very low prices. But if you see the other end of the spectrum, other end of the market, if you see, there are so many stocks which is anti-gravity. Anti-gravity means price never falling in spite of whatever news we are getting anywhere in the market. These are some of the stocks which are not at all falling in the market. For example, paint companies, Asian Paint and Berger Paint. If you see, means these stocks continuously going up. Even if you have a small correction, then again it will start going up. Almost Asian Paint is trading at 66 PE, Berger is 92 PE. Few years back, these stocks were trading around 30 PE. Asian Paint is generally used to trade at a higher PE than Berger Paint. Now Berger Paint is trading at a much higher valuation than Asian Paint. So Berger Paint is trading at 92 PE. Relaxo Footwear Company, it is continuously going up. These stocks, whatever news come, will never fall. It is trading at 80 PE. Similarly, MNC company Nestle, it will keep on growing. It previously Nestle used to grow at 20% like that. Now the growth has come down because of slowdown economy. On the other hand, Nestle previously used to trade at 30 to 40 PE. Now PE has gone to 85. About if you see, which is a pharmaceutical company, many of them are telling that after the 3 or 4 years, this company will come into the index. It is trading at 52 PE. Bajaj Finance, 49 PE. Pretty light. It also never falls. You can maximum get a 10% to 15% correction. Then again, that correction will be bought into it. Again, it will make new high. It is 66. Info Edge, which is nothing but the Naukri portal, they are running it. Similarly, they have stake in food supply, Zomato. They have some stake in that. And that is trading at 100 PE. PVR Cinemas, initially they were telling that the one Rajini movie came is going to be a grand success, so PVR will keep on going up. But that movie got flopped. Still, the stock prices have been going up. Now it has crossed 75 PE now. Jubilant Food, results were average only. Last year, this year if you compare, means operating profit is almost the same only. No growth is there, but stock price went up from 1300 to 1900. Trend, which is nothing but an erstwhile Lakme, old Lakme name, Trend, which runs a retail textile chains of shop. So it is traded at 246 PE. Yesterday it went up further by 6-7% after the result came. T-Mart, everyone knows that, like Big Bazaar, they are having shops. It is trading at 100 PE, 130. So if you, Bajaj Finance is, if you take in this list, everything is trading at very high PE. Bajaj Finance has a good growth rate. Almost 40% growth they are showing it. Similarly, about, even though sales is not growing to that extent, profit is growing because of their innovative products they are launching in India. Many combination drugs and drugs they are launching in India, which is a high margin product. So their profit is very high, even though sales growth is normal only. So if you leave aside this about Bajaj Finance, all other companies are having only nominal growth only. We can't tell a superlative growth, but still everything is going up and continuously going up. And if you see the PE of ONGC, it is at 5 PE. It's at a good cash flow, but because of a continuous sell-off by the government, this used to happen. So if you see stock price, two things are there. One is the fundamental and second one is the technicals. Technicals means buyers, less what they are doing it. So on the PSU stocks, continuous selling is coming, whereas in this type of shares, Info Edge and all, floating stock is very less. No floating stock is there. So only few percentage of shares available for public. So keep on prices going up. Trend also one way movement only. So like that, it is there in the market, two sides of a coin. So finally, this is the last one. Tesla, without telling the Tesla chart, most of them might have known that name. Tesla is nothing but the electric vehicle manufacturer in US. So it has a very good technology, battery technology, everything inside. If you see, that means the last 5 years, even though US market has been doing extremely well, this stock did not give enough return. What the price was in 2015, the same thing was in 2020 also. Almost 5 years, the stock did not give any return. It was trading around 200, but within 3 months, what happened is that it from 200 it went to almost it went to 900. Now it has fell to 748. So within 3-4 months, the stock has gone up by 4 times. So many times this also happened. Some stocks, no, they won't do for 5 years. No return they will give, but within 4-5 months it will go up. So stock market is sometimes a patience game also. We have to be very patient sometimes. Yeah. have very confidence on the stock. If the company is doing well, means then sometimes stock price won't go up. Like in many POC stocks, it is happening now. Because of technical issues, the stock price has been continuously falling. And he wants to watch the coronavirus, we have to see. FII activity, we have to see. Because FIIs are heavily short in the market. One of the huge short position. Net long is just 18% they are having. One of the lowest in many years. Whether they will cover the short position or sell their holdings, that would have to be seen in coming days. Thank you.
നമ്മൾ ഫസ്റ്റ് കൊടുത്തിരിക്കുന്ന റെക്കമെൻഡേഷൻ കുറച്ച് വാല്യൂ പിക്കാണ് ഇപ്രാവശ്യം കൊടുത്തിരിക്കുന്നത്. ഫസ്റ്റ് നോക്കുകയാണെങ്കിൽ ഭാരത് എയർടെൽ. നമുക്ക് അറിയാം ടെലികോം സ്റ്റോക്സിലൊക്കെ ഒരു 4-5 വർഷമായിട്ട് എല്ലാം ഭയങ്കര ഡൗൺ ആണ്. ഇപ്പൊ ഒരു റിവൈവൽ പാത്തിലാണ്. കാരണം ഒരുപാട് പ്ലെയേഴ്സ് ഉണ്ടായിരുന്നു, അതിൽ നിന്ന് കുറഞ്ഞു കുറഞ്ഞു കുറഞ്ഞ് ഇപ്പം 3-4 പ്ലെയേഴ്സായി. അപ്പൊ അതിൽ കുറച്ച് സർവൈവ് ചെയ്യാൻ സാധ്യതയുള്ള ഒരു കാൻഡിഡേറ്റ് ആണ് ഭാരത് എയർടെൽ. ഇപ്പൊ ലോസാണ്, ലാസ്റ്റ് 3 ക്വാർട്ടറിൽ ലോസ് കാണിച്ചിട്ടുണ്ട്. അതുകൊണ്ടാണ് നമ്മൾ പി റേഷ്യോ കൊടുത്തിട്ടില്ല. പക്ഷേ ഓൾമോസ്റ്റ് അവരുടെ ഒരു ബാഡ് ഫേസ് ഒക്കെ തീർന്നു കഴിഞ്ഞു, റവന്യൂ നല്ല രീതിയിൽ കൂടുന്നുണ്ട്. നമുക്കറിയാം ഡിസംബർ തൊട്ട് കോൾ ചാർജസ് ഒക്കെ ഹൈക്ക് ചെയ്തിട്ടുണ്ട്. ഇപ്പൊ കോൾ ചാർജസ് ഹൈക്ക് ചെയ്തുകൊണ്ട് ഇനിയിപ്പോ റവന്യൂ നല്ല രീതിയിൽ കൂടും. അപ്പം അടുത്തൊരു ടേൺ ഓവർ കാണണ്ടാണ്. കാരണം ഒരു 5-6 ഇയേഴ്സ് ആയിട്ട് ഇതൊന്നും ഓൾ ടൈം ലോ ഹൈയുടെ താഴെയാണ് ട്രേഡ് ചെയ്യുന്നത്. അപ്പൊ ഇപ്പൊ ഒരു ലാസ്റ്റ് 1 മന്ത് ഡിസംബർ തൊട്ട് നല്ലൊരു മൊമെന്റം ഉണ്ട്. അപ്പൊ ഈ ലെവലിൽ നമുക്ക് മേടിക്കാവുന്നതാണ്, ഒരു ടേൺ ഓവർ കാൻഡിഡേറ്റ് ആയിട്ട് മേടിക്കാവുന്നതാണ്. സെക്കൻഡ് നോക്കുകയാണെങ്കിൽ ഫോഴ്സ് മോട്ടറാണ്. അപ്പം ഇതിന്റെയൊക്കെ ഒരു ഇതൊരു മൾട്ടി യൂട്ടിലിറ്റി വെഹിക്കിളിൽ പബ്ലിക് ട്രാൻസ്പോർട്ട് വെഹിക്കിൾ എന്ന് പറയും. ഒരു 15-20 സീറ്റർ വെഹിക്കിൾസ് ആണ് കൂടുതലും. ഇതിന്റെയൊക്കെ സെയിൽസ് വളരെ കുറവായിരുന്നു കഴിഞ്ഞ 1 വർഷമായിട്ട്. ഇപ്പൊ ലാസ്റ്റ് 3 മന്ത്സ് ആയിട്ട് നോക്കുകയാണെങ്കിൽ മന്ത്ലി സെയിൽസ് 30-40% റൈസ് ആയി തുടങ്ങി കഴിഞ്ഞു. ഇപ്പം ബാക്കിയുള്ള വെഹിക്കിൾസ് ഒക്കെ ടാറ്റാ മോട്ടർ അതുപോലെ അശോക് ലെയ്ലാൻഡ് ഒക്കെ നോക്കുകയാണെങ്കിൽ അവരുടെ സെയിൽസ് ഒന്നും ഇമ്പ്രൂവ് ആയി തുടങ്ങിയിട്ടില്ല. അപ്പൊ ഇതിന്റെ സെയിൽസ് നല്ല ഇമ്പ്രൂവ് ആയി തുടങ്ങി. ഇതൊരു കമേഴ്സ്യൽ വെഹിക്കിളും വരത്തില്ല, പാസഞ്ചർ കാർ ഒരു മിഡ് സൈസ് വെഹിക്കിളാണ്. കാരണം ഒരു പബ്ലിക് ട്രാൻസ്പോർട്ട് എന്നുള്ള രീതിയിലാണ് ഒരു 15-16 പാസഞ്ചേഴ്സ് കൊണ്ടുപോകുന്ന വണ്ടികളാണ്. അപ്പൊ ഇത് നല്ല സെയിൽസ് തുടങ്ങിയിട്ടുണ്ട്. ഇതിനൊക്കെ ഒരു സെയിൽസ് ഇമ്പ്രൂവ് ആയി തുടങ്ങി കഴിഞ്ഞാൽ കണ്ടിന്യൂ ചെയ്യാൻ സാധ്യതയുണ്ട്. ജനറലി മാർച്ചിലൊക്കെ സ്കൂൾ ബസ്സിന്റെ ഒക്കെ ഓർഡർ എപ്പോഴും കൂടുതൽ വരുന്നത് ഫെബ്രുവരി മാർച്ചിലാണ്. അപ്പൊ ഒരു സെയിൽസ് അതിന്റെ ഒരു മൊമെന്റം കണ്ടിന്യൂയാണ്. ഇപ്പൊ നല്ലൊരു 900-ന്റെ ലെവൽസ് വരെ വന്നിട്ടുണ്ടായിരുന്നു. ഇപ്പൊ നല്ലൊരു പ്രൈസ് വന്നിട്ടുണ്ട്. കാരണം നേരത്തെയുള്ള ഹൈ എന്ന് പറയുന്നത് 4,900 വരെ 2018 പോയ ഷെയർ ആണ്. ഈ ലെവൽ നമുക്ക് മേടിക്കാമെന്നാണ്. നല്ലൊരു മൊമെന്റും ഉണ്ട്, സെയിൽസ് നല്ല ഫണ്ടമെന്റൽസും നല്ല ഇമ്പ്രൂവ് ആയി തുടങ്ങി, മേടിക്കാമെന്നാണ്. നമ്മൾ തേർഡ് നോക്കുകയാണെങ്കിൽ അലംബിക് ഫാർമ. അപ്പൊ നമുക്ക് നോക്കുകയാണെങ്കിൽ ഈ ഫാർമസ്യൂട്ടിക്കൽ കമ്പനിയൊക്കെ ഒരുപാട് US FDA ഇഷ്യൂസ് ഉണ്ടായിരുന്നു. ഇപ്പൊ അലംബിക്കിൽ നോക്കുകയാണെങ്കിൽ ഏറ്റവും കുറഞ്ഞ US FDA എക്സ്പോർട്ടിലുള്ള US FDA ഇഷ്യൂ ഉള്ള ഒരു കമ്പനിയാണ്. അതിൽ കമ്പനി ഏകദേശം 1,500 crores ഇൻവെസ്റ്റ് ചെയ്തിട്ടുണ്ട് റിസർച്ച് ആൻഡ് ഡെവലപ്മെന്റിലൊക്കെ. അപ്പൊ അതിന്റെയൊക്കെ ഇമ്പാക്ട് നെക്സ്റ്റ് ഇയർ സെയിൽസിലെ വരത്തുള്ളൂ. അതുപോലെ റിസൾട്ട് നല്ല റിസൾട്ട് കാണിക്കുന്നുണ്ട്. കമ്പാരിറ്റീവ്ലി ഒരു കുറച്ച് നല്ല കമ്പനിയാണ്. കാരണം അധികം ഇഷ്യൂസ് ഇല്ലാത്ത കമ്പനിയാണ്. വാല്യുവേഷൻ നോക്കുകയാണെങ്കിലും ഒരു 17-18 PE ട്രേഡ് ചെയ്യുന്നുള്ളൂ. കാരണം 2013-14 ആയിരുന്നു ഈ ഫാർമ സ്റ്റോക്സിന്റെ ഒരു നല്ല നമുക്കൊരു ബുൾ റൺ കണ്ടത് ഫാർമ സെക്ടറിന്റെ. അത് കഴിഞ്ഞിട്ട് ഒരു 3-4 ഇയേഴ്സ് ആയിട്ട് എല്ലാ ഫാർമ സ്റ്റോക്സും ഡൗൺ ആണ്. ഇപ്പൊ ലാസ്റ്റ് 1 മന്ത് ആയിട്ട് ഫാർമ സ്റ്റോക്സിലൊക്കെ നല്ല ബയ്യിങ് വരുന്നുണ്ട്. പകുതി റീസൺ എന്ന് പറഞ്ഞാൽ ഈ ചൈനയിലുള്ള പ്രോബ്ലം ആണ്. കാരണം അവിടുത്തെ റാ മെറ്റീരിയൽ ഒന്നും ഇനിയിപ്പം പെട്ടെന്ന് വരത്തില്ല, എല്ലാത്തിനും പ്രൈസ് കൂടുന്നുള്ള ഒരു വ്യൂ ഉണ്ട്. പിന്നെ കുറച്ച് റീസൺ എന്ന് പറയുമ്പോൾ US ലുള്ള ഇഷ്യൂസ് ഒക്കെ സോർട്ട് ഔട്ട് ആയി, US സെയിൽസ് ഇമ്പ്രൂവ് ആയി തുടങ്ങി പല കമ്പനീസിനും. അതിൽ ഒന്നാമത്തെ കമ്പനിയാണ് ഈ അലംബിക് ഫാർമ. ഈ ലെവലിൽ മേടിക്കാവുന്നതാണ്. കാരണം ഇതൊരു മിക്കവാറും ഇപ്പൊ ഒരു മിഡ് ക്യാപ് കാറ്റഗറിയിലാണ് നിൽക്കുന്നത്. കുറച്ച് കുറച്ചായിട്ട് അതൊരു ഇമ്പ്രൂവ് ആയി ഒരു ലാർജ് ക്യാപ് കാറ്റഗറിയിലൊക്കെ പോകാനും സാധ്യതയുള്ള ഒരു കമ്പനിയാണ്, നമുക്ക് മേടിക്കാവുന്നതാണ്. പിന്നെ ഫോർത്ത് നോക്കുകയാണെങ്കിൽ റാലീസിന്റെ ആണ്. അതൊരു ടാറ്റ കമ്പനിയാണ്, അഗ്രികൾച്ചർ ഓറിയന്റഡുള്ള ഫെർട്ടിലൈസർ ആൻഡ് കെമിക്കൽസ് അഗ്രോ കെമിക്കൽ കമ്പനിയാണ്. ഇതിന്റെ ഒരു പ്ലസ് പോയിന്റ് പറയുമ്പോൾ ഇവര് പൊതുവായിട്ടൊരു പ്ലാന്റിലൊക്കെ ഇൻവെസ്റ്റ് ചെയ്തിട്ടുണ്ട്. കാര്യം റാ മെറ്റീരിയലും ഇതും ചൈനയിൽ നിന്നൊക്കെയാണ് സോഴ്സ് ചെയ്യുന്നത് ഈ കമ്പനീസൊക്കെ, കെമിക്കൽ കമ്പനീസിനൊക്കെ, അഗ്രോ കെമിക്കൽ കമ്പനീസിനൊക്കെ. അപ്പൊ അതിന്റെ ഇമ്പാക്ട് ഇനി കുറയും. നെക്സ്റ്റ് ഇയർ തൊട്ട് ഫുള്ളി അവര് ഇന്റേണൽ ആയി പോകും. റാ മെറ്റീരിയൽ അന്ന് ഫുള്ളി ആയിട്ട് ഇന്റേണൽ ആയി പോകും. അപ്പൊ അതുകൊണ്ട് ഇവർക്ക് ഇമ്പോർട്ടിന്റെ പ്രോബ്ലം ഒന്നും വരുന്നില്ല. അതുപോലെ ചൈന കൺസേൺ ഒന്നും വരുന്നില്ല. അതുപോലെ ഒരുപാട് പ്രോഡക്റ്റ് ലോഞ്ച് ചെയ്യുന്നുണ്ട്. അവരുടെ പുതിയ പുതിയ ഫെർട്ടിലൈസറും അതുപോലെ പെസ്റ്റിസൈഡ്സ് ഒക്കെ ലോഞ്ച് ചെയ്യുന്നുണ്ട്. ഇപ്പൊ കഴിഞ്ഞ മാസം റിസൾട്ടും ഈ ക്വാർട്ടറിൽ റിസൾട്ടും നല്ല റിസൾട്ടായിരുന്നു. നമ്മൾ മുമ്പും റെക്കമെൻഡ് ചെയ്തിട്ടുണ്ടായിരുന്നു, പക്ഷെ ഒന്നിരും ഒരു 5-6 മാസമായിട്ട് സബ്ഡ്യൂഡ് ആയിരുന്നു. ഇപ്പൊ നല്ല ബയ്യിങ് വരുന്നുണ്ട്. ഒരു ലോങ് ടേം വ്യൂവിലും നമുക്ക് ഹോൾഡ് ചെയ്യാം, ഒരു 6 മന്ത്സ് വ്യൂവിലും നമുക്ക് മേടിക്കാവുന്നതാണ്, നല്ലൊരു കമ്പനിയാണ്. ലാസ്റ്റ് നമ്മൾ കൊടുത്തിരിക്കുന്ന CDSL ആണ്. നമുക്കെല്ലാം അറിയാം ഡെപ്പോസിറ്ററി ആണ് CDSL. ഇതിന്റെ ഒരു പ്ലസ് പോയിന്റ് എന്ന് പറയുമ്പോൾ ഒരുപാട് അൺലിസ്റ്റഡ് ഫേംസ് ഒക്കെ ലിസ്റ്റ് ഡീമെറ്റലൈസ് ചെയ്തു തുടങ്ങി കഴിഞ്ഞാൽ അതുപോലെ ഈ ഫ്യൂച്ചറിൽ എൽ ഐ സി പോളിസി അതുപോലെ റിയൽ എസ്റ്റേറ്റ് എല്ലാം ഡിമാറ്റിൽ കൊണ്ടുവരുന്നതാണ് ഗവൺമെന്റിന്റെ ഒരു പ്ലാൻ. പക്ഷെ ഇപ്പം അൺലിസ്റ്റഡ് ഫേംസ് തന്നെ അൺലിസ്റ്റഡ് കമ്പനീസ് തന്നെ വരുമ്പോൾ തന്നെ നമ്മൾ ഈ കൊച്ചിൻ ഷിപ്പ്യാർഡ് പോലത്തെ കമ്പനീസ് ഒക്കെ അല്ല കൊച്ചിൻ എയർപോർട്ടൊക്കെ ഈ അതിലൊക്കെ വന്നു കഴിഞ്ഞാൽ തന്നെ ഒരുപാട് വന്നു തുടങ്ങി. അതുപോലെ ഇപ്പൊ കാപ്പിറ്റലൈസ് ചെയ്യുമ്പോൾ അങ്ങ് ഐ പി ഒ മുമ്പ് തന്നെ എല്ലാവരും ഡിമാറ്റ് ചെയ്ത് കഴിഞ്ഞു. അപ്പൊ ഡിമാറ്റിന്റെ നമ്പർ ഓഫ് കമ്പനീസ് ഒരുപാട് കൂടുന്നുണ്ട്. പിന്നെ ഒരു പ്ലസ് പോയിന്റ് പറയുമ്പോൾ ഇവരുടെ ചാർജസ് ഉണ്ട്. ചാർജസ് വന്ന് 2015 ഇവർ റൈസ് ചെയ്ത് എവരി 5 ആണ് ഇവർ റൈസ് ചെയ്യുന്നത്. ഇപ്പൊ 2020 അടുത്തൊരു ചാർജസ് റിവിഷൻ വരുന്നത്, ഡി പി ചാർജസ് ഒക്കെ റിവിഷൻ വരുന്നത്. അപ്പൊ അതൊരു റവന്യൂയുടെ ഒരു നെക്സ്റ്റ് സ്റ്റേജ് ആയിരിക്കും. ഇപ്പൊ നമുക്ക് കിട്ടുന്ന ആ റവന്യൂയുടെ ഒരു ഒരു ഗ്രോത്ത് കാണിക്കും. സഡൻലി ഒരു ഒരു 20% ചാർജസ് ഹൈക്ക് ചെയ്ത് കഴിഞ്ഞാൽ നെക്സ്റ്റ് ക്വാർട്ടർ തൊട്ട് 20% ഗ്രോത്ത് ഈ ഹൈക്ക് കൊണ്ട് തന്നെ വരും. അപ്പൊ അതിന്റെ അടുത്തൊരു നെക്സ്റ്റ് ലെവലിലോട്ട് പോകുന്നതാണ് കമ്പനി. ഈ ലെവൽ മേടിക്കാനുള്ളത് ജനറലി ഒരു 6 നല്ലൊരു റിട്ടേൺ കിട്ടുന്നതാണ്, നല്ലൊരു ഹൈക്ക് വരുന്നതാണ്. കഴിഞ്ഞ മാസത്തിന്റെ റെക്കമെൻഡേഷൻ ആണ്. നമ്മൾ കാൻഫിൻ ഹോംസ് നല്ലൊരു അപ്രിസിയേഷൻ കിട്ടിയിട്ടുണ്ടായിരുന്നു, 25% അപ്രിസിയേഷൻ കിട്ടി. ടാറ്റ ഗ്ലോബൽ ബിവറേജസും നല്ല ഹൈ ഉണ്ടായിരുന്നു, 4008 വരെ ഹൈ പോയിട്ടുണ്ട്. ഇറങ്ങിയത് ബാലറാംപൂർ ചീനിയാണ്. കാര്യം ഈ പെട്രോൾ വില പെട്ടെന്ന് കുറയുമ്പോൾ, ക്രൂഡ് ഓയിലിന്റെ വില കുറയുമ്പോൾ ഈ എത്തനോൾ ബ്ലെൻഡിങ്ങിന്റെ ഒരു ഇമ്പോർട്ടൻസ് കുറച്ച് കുറഞ്ഞു വന്നു. അതുകൊണ്ടാണ് ഈ ഷുഗർ സ്റ്റോക്സ് ഒക്കെ ഒന്ന് കറക്റ്റ് ചെയ്തത്, അല്ലെങ്കിൽ ഹോൾഡ് ചെയ്യണം. കാരണം ഈ ബ്രൺ ക്രൂഡ് ഓയിൽ കുറച്ച് തിരിച്ച് റിവൈസ് ആയിട്ടുണ്ട് പ്രൈസസ്. പിന്നെ ഡോക്ടർ റെഡ്ഡിയും 8% ഉണ്ട്. സ്റ്റീൽ കമ്പനീസ് കുറച്ച് സബ്ഡ്യൂഡ് ആയിട്ട് നിൽക്കുന്നത്, അതിന്റെ രണ്ട് റീസൺ ഉണ്ട്. ഒന്ന് ചൈന കൺസേൺ ആയതുകൊണ്ട് സ്റ്റീലിന്റെ ഗ്ലോബലായിട്ട് സ്റ്റീൽ പ്രൈസിന്റെ ഒരു കറക്ഷൻ വന്നു. പിന്നെ ഈ സ്ക്രാപ്പ് ടെക്നോളജീസ് വല്ലതും വരികയാണെങ്കിൽ ഒരുപാട് സ്ക്രാപ്പ് സ്റ്റീൽസ് വരും. അപ്പം അത് ഈ സ്റ്റീൽസ് കമ്പനീസ് നെഗറ്റീവ് ആണെന്നൊരു വ്യൂ വരുന്നുണ്ട്. അപ്പൊ ഗവൺമെന്റ് കുറെ 2-3 സ്ക്രാപ്പ് പോളിസി അനൗൺസ് ചെയ്യുന്നു ഇങ്ങനെ പോയിക്കൊണ്ടിരിക്കുകയാണ്. അപ്പൊ അതുപോലെ അനൗൺസ് ചെയ്യുകയാണെങ്കിൽ ഈ അശോക് ലേലാൻഡ് പോലുള്ള വെഹിക്കിൾസിന്, ടാറ്റ മോട്ടർ, അശോക് ലേലാൻഡ്, ഫോഴ്സ് മോട്ടർ ഇതുപോലത്തെ ഉള്ള മെയിൻ കമേഴ്സ് വെഹിക്കിളുള്ള അശോക് ലേലാൻഡ്, ടാറ്റ മോട്ടോർ, കുറച്ച് മഹേന്ദ്ര, ഇതൊക്കെ പോസിറ്റീവ് ആണ്. പക്ഷെ സ്റ്റീൽ കമ്പനീസിന് ശകലം നെഗറ്റീവ് ആയിട്ട് വരുന്നതാണ്. അപ്പൊ കഴിഞ്ഞ മാസത്തിന് അത് നോക്കുകയാണെങ്കിൽ നിഫ്റ്റി ആൾ ടൈം ഹൈ അടിച്ചിട്ടുണ്ടായിരുന്നു. നിഫ്റ്റി 12,430 വരെ വന്നിട്ടുണ്ടായിരുന്നു. പിന്നെയാണ് ആ ഒരു കറക്ഷൻ വന്നത്. രണ്ട് റീസൺ ഉണ്ടായിരുന്നു. ഒന്ന് ചൈനയുടെ റീസണും പിന്നെ ബഡ്ജറ്റിന്റെ അന്നും മാർക്കറ്റ് നല്ല രീതിയിൽ കറക്റ്റ് ചെയ്തിട്ടുണ്ടായിരുന്നു. അപ്പം റീസെന്റ് ഹൈ എന്ന് പറയുന്നത് ആൾടൈം ഹൈ എന്ന് പറയുന്നത് 12,430 മാർക്കറ്റ് ഹിറ്റ് ചെയ്തിട്ടുണ്ട്. ചാനൽസ് നോക്കുകയാണെങ്കിൽ ആദ്യം ഒരു ഡൗൺവേർഡ് ചാനൽ ഉണ്ടായിരുന്നു, ഒരു അപ്പ്വേർഡ്, പിന്നെ ഡൗൺവേർഡ്, പിന്നെ അപ്പ്വേർഡ് ചാനൽ വന്നിട്ട് ഒരു അതിൽ നിന്ന് ഒരു ബ്രേക്ക്ഔട്ട് ആയി, ബ്രേക്ക് ഡൗൺ ആയി താഴോട്ട് വന്നിട്ടുണ്ടായിരുന്നു. അപ്പം ചാനൽ കുറച്ച് വൈലേറ്റ് ചെയ്തിട്ടുണ്ട്, പക്ഷെ തിരിച്ച് മാർക്കറ്റ് ഇപ്പം കയറുന്നുണ്ട്. അപ്പൊ അങ്ങനെ നോക്കുകയാണെങ്കിൽ 12,300 ആണ് ആ ഒരു ഏകദേശം 12,300-350 ലെവലാണ് ചാനലിന്റെ ഒരു ലോവർ ലെവൽ വരുന്നത്. കാര്യം ഇത് അപ്പോഴ് ട്രെൻഡിങ് ചാനൽ ആയതുകൊണ്ട് റൈസ് ആയിക്കൊണ്ടേയിരിക്കും ലെവൽ. അപ്പൊ ഈ 12,300 അല്ലെങ്കിൽ 350 എബോവ് പോയി കഴിഞ്ഞാൽ മാർക്കറ്റ് പിന്നെയും ബുള്ളിഷാവും. അപ്പൊ ഇപ്പൊ ഒരു നോക്കുകയാണെങ്കിൽ നിഫ്റ്റി ഒരു കൺസോൾട്ടേഷൻ ആണ്. നമ്മൾ ലാസ്റ്റ് ഒരു 3-4 നോക്കുകയാണെങ്കിലും 1-2 മാർക്കറ്റ് കയറിട്ട് ഇപ്പൊ നിഫ്റ്റി കുറച്ച് ഒരു ചെറിയ റേഞ്ച് ആയിട്ടാണ് ട്രേഡ് ചെയ്യുന്നത്. പക്ഷെ മിഡ് ആൻഡ് സ്മോൾ ക്യാപ്പിലാണ് ഏറ്റവും കൂടുതൽ ആക്ടിവിറ്റീസ് വരുന്നത്. ഇതാണ് നമ്മൾ ലാസ്റ്റ് 2018 തൊട്ടുള്ള ലെവൽസ് ആണ്. നിഫ്റ്റി നോക്കുകയാണെങ്കിൽ 14% പീക്കിൽ നിന്ന് വന്നിട്ടുണ്ടെങ്കിൽ ഇപ്പൊ അത് 3% ഡൗണിലേ ഉള്ളൂ. പക്ഷെ മിഡ് ക്യാപ്പ് നോക്കുകയാണെങ്കിൽ 31% നമ്മൾ 2018 ഹൈ നിന്ന് ഡൗൺ പോയിട്ടുണ്ടായിരുന്നു. ഇപ്പൊ ആൾമോസ്റ്റ് 16% ഡൗണേ ഉള്ളൂ. അപ്പം 31-16 ആയി കഴിഞ്ഞു. അപ്പൊ ആൾമോസ്റ്റ് 50% ആണ് മിഡ് ക്യാപ്പ് റീട്രേസ് ചെയ്ത് കഴിഞ്ഞു. അതുപോലെ സ്മോൾ ക്യാപ്പ് നോക്കുകയാണെങ്കിൽ 47% ഡൗൺ പോയിട്ടുണ്ടായിരുന്നു. നമ്മൾ സ്മോൾ ക്യാപ്പ് ഇൻഡെക്സ് ഓൾ ടൈം ഹൈ എന്ന് പറയുമ്പോൾ 9,656 എന്ന് ആൾമോസ്റ്റ് 50% ആണ് സ്മോൾ ക്യാപ്പ് ഇൻഡെക്സ് ഡൗൺ ആയത്. അതുകൊണ്ടാണ് നമ്മുടെ മിഡ് ആൻഡ് സ്മോൾ ക്യാപ്പ് പോർട്ട്ഫോളിയോ ഒക്കെ വളരെ ഡൗൺ ആയിരുന്നു, ഈ ലാർജ് ക്യാപ്പ് സ്റ്റോക്സ് മാത്രം റൈസ് ചെയ്തുകൊണ്ടിരുന്നത്. ഇപ്പൊ തിരിച്ച് 35% ഡൗൺ ആണ്, സ്റ്റിൽ 35% ഡൗൺ ആണ്. അപ്പൊ കമ്പാരിറ്റീവ് മിഡ് ക്യാപ്പ് നല്ല രീതിയിൽ ഡൗണിൽ നിന്ന് റീട്രേസ് ചെയ്ത് വന്നിട്ടുണ്ട്. പക്ഷെ സ്മോൾ ക്യാപ്പ് സ്റ്റിൽ ഫാർ ഇതാണ്, ഫാർ ബിലോ ആണ്. അതായത് 12% റീട്രേസ് ചെയ്തിട്ടുണ്ട്. അപ്പൊ സ്മോൾ ക്യാപ്പ് ഇനിയും ഒരുപാട് റൈസ് ചെയ്യാറുണ്ട്. അതുകൊണ്ടാണ് നമ്മൾ നോക്കുകയാണെങ്കിൽ ഒരുപാട് മിഡ് ആൻഡ് സ്മോൾ ക്യാപ്പ് നല്ല ആക്ടിവിറ്റീസ് ഉണ്ട്. പക്ഷെ ലാർജ് ക്യാപ്പ് കുറച്ച് കൺസോൾട്ടേഷൻ ഫേസിലോട്ടാണ് പോകുന്നത്. ഇതാണ് ആ ഒരു ഇത്. നമ്മൾ ചാനൽ ഡൗൺവേർഡ് ചാനലാണ്. നമ്മൾ നിഫ്റ്റി ആയാലും ഒരു ഡൗൺ കഴിഞ്ഞിട്ട് ഒരു അപ്പ്വേർഡ് ചാനൽ ഉണ്ടായിരുന്നത്. മിഡ് ക്യാപ്പ് നല്ലൊരു ഡൗൺവേർഡ് ചാനൽ വന്നിട്ട് സെപ്റ്റംബറിലാണ് ലോ വന്നത്. അതിൽ നിന്ന് ഇപ്പൊ ആൾമോസ്റ്റ് ഈ ചാനലിലൊക്കെ വൈലേറ്റ് ചെയ്ത് നല്ലൊരു ഹൈലാണ് നിൽക്കുന്നത്. ഇത് സ്മോൾ ക്യാപ്പാണ്. സ്മോൾ ക്യാപ്പിന്റെ കറക്ഷൻ കുറച്ചുകൂടെ ഷാർപ്പാണ്. അതിന് 50% ഡൗൺ ആയിരുന്നു. അതിൽ നിന്ന് ഇപ്പം ആ ചാനലൊക്കെ വൈലേറ്റ് ചെയ്ത് ഒരു പോസിറ്റീവ് സോണിലാണ് സ്മോൾ ക്യാപ്പ് ഒക്കെ നിൽക്കുന്നത്. അൺലെസ് ഇത് ബ്രേക്ക് ചെയ്ത് താഴോട്ട് പോയില്ലെങ്കിൽ ഇതൊക്കെ ഒരു കണ്ടിന്യൂ ഇൻഡെക്സ് ലെവലിൽ കണ്ടിന്യൂ എന്നാണ്. ഇതാണ് ഒരു സപ്പോർട്ട് ആൻഡ് റെസിസ്റ്റൻസ്. നമ്മൾ ഇമ്മീഡിയറ്റ് ആയിട്ട് നോക്കുന്നത് 12,000 ആണെങ്കിൽ നല്ലൊരു സപ്പോർട്ട് എന്ന് പറയുമ്പോൾ 11,800 ആണ്. അപ്പൊ 11,800 12,300 റേഞ്ചിലായിരിക്കും മാർക്കറ്റ് ട്രേഡ് ചെയ്യുന്നത്. 12,300 ഒക്കെ ബ്രേക്ക് ചെയ്ത് പോയി കഴിഞ്ഞാൽ പിന്നെ ഓൾ ടൈം ഹൈ ആയിട്ടുള്ള 12,430 ആയിരിക്കും. പിന്നെ മാർക്കറ്റ് നല്ല ബുള്ളിഷ് ആവും, ന്യൂ ഹൈ വരും. ഡൗൺ സൈഡ് നോക്കുകയാണെങ്കിൽ 11,800 ഹോൾഡ് ചെയ്യുകയാണെങ്കിൽ മാർക്കറ്റ് നെഗറ്റീവ് അല്ല, ഒരു കൺസോളിഡേഷൻ പ്രൈസ് നമുക്ക് പറയാം. അൺലെസ് 12,800 ലെവൽ ബ്രേക്ക് ചെയ്താല് നമുക്കൊരു നെഗറ്റീവ് വരുന്നുള്ളൂ, അതുവരെ മാർക്കറ്റ് ഒരു കൺസോളിഡേഷൻ പ്രൈസിലായിരിക്കും. ഓക്കെ, താങ്ക് യു.